morning to everyone, and welcome to the third annual State of the City event. Thank you for starting your day with us this morning. As everyone knows who lives here, Santa Cruz is a very special place. I'm honored to serve as your mayor this year, and it's really an honor to see all of the faces out here, not only from our downtown business community, from our nonprofits, but from throughout the city who make this place such a special community. I'd like to take a moment and begin the program with some introductions. Sure. First of all, I'd like to introduce Emmanuel Garcia, who's representing Congressman Panetta. Also, I believe Supervisor Friend was planning to join us today as well. Also, we have Councilmember Naroyan, Councilmember Chase, Councilmember Matthews, former Mayor Don Lane, and former Mayor Hillary Bryant as well. I'd also like to recognize Superintendent Chris Monroe and also some special guests we have from Santa Cruz City High School, Councilor Samuel Solis, Daniela Werlin Martinez, Cameron Botcher, and Thomas Tremholm. You guys want to stand up and say hello? And then from Soquel High School, Assistant Principal Jose Quevedo, Evelyn Gonzalez, Madison Gotthard, and Carlos Mercado. If you'd please. Thank you for being here this morning. As mayor, people often share experiences they have with Santa Cruz. And just like in the old Western, it's the good, the bad, and the ugly. However, more often than not, people share with me their love of living here in Santa Cruz. And so I'm going to go off script for a moment and ask you, what do you love about living here in Santa Cruz this morning? Anyone who wants to share it, love to hear from you. Anyone?
Friends.
The community.
The surf.
Hiking.
You know, those are all of the things that I feel make Santa Cruz such a special place. We all have in our hearts the idea of what is an ideal community. I think as a city council, we work very hard to focus on those priorities to make our city a special place. I think that for me being here as your mayor this year, to hear, we want to provide you with these updates on the city, on what people are doing here in Santa Cruz, not only in our business community, but our nonprofits that make our community such a special place. During the presentation today, City Manager Martine Bernal will share some background on the city's budget, challenges, Measure S, as well as what we're doing here to address the homeless population in our city. Lee Butler, our still relatively new planning director, will share updates with you on citywide projects, as well as changes being made in the planning department to better respond to business needs. And finally, arts program manager Beth Toby will provide a quick overview of the city's public arts program. First, I'd like to share with you, though, the significant work that's taken place on our city council two-year work plan. It was just in June 2017 that the city council provided direction to staff to focus on three areas. In the past, we had a wide variety of projects that were coming forward to the staff, and we used this as an opportunity to narrow in on three priority areas. Those three areas are public safety and well-being, housing, and infrastructure. In regards to public safety, as many of you all have experienced, the city's hired a new police chief, Andy Mills, who's also here. Since the time of his hiring, he's led the department and met with neighborhoods from throughout the city to learn about their safety needs, and then redesigned the department to better be able to respond to city public safety issues by neighborhood. Also supported the police department in the development of new methods to better manage calls for service and the production of ongoing crime reporting. We've also supported the installation of new security cameras, systems on the river levee, which stretches from Soquel Avenue to Laurel, and also taken part in better steps to better manage the safety needs in our parks through increased staffing of our park rangers and through the implementation of ordinances to better manage our safety needs in the parks. In regards to our housing, there's been a lot of work that's happened there as well. We've entered into a new purchase and sale agreement for the NIAC building downtown to better support the creation of new affordable housing in the downtown. We participated in the landlord incentive program for Section 8 tenants. We've also issued 1,371 residential building permits just in the past year to better increase the production of new housing units in the city. We've also approved the planning permits for 104 affordable housing units in the city. And in regards to housing, we've also funded a portion of the Habitat for Humanity home and ADU and completed the construction of the first ADU under the My House, My Home program directly related to seniors here in our city to support them in their housing needs. In regards to infrastructure, we've acquired over $2.6 million in transportation safety and infrastructure grants through our Public Works Department, which helps to fund intersection improvements at Highway 1 and 9, improves the paving on River Street, and rehab sidewalks on Pacific Avenue between 2nd and 1st Front Streets. Also, the bridge at Branson Forty Creek was completed. How many of you use that bridge? It's great, isn't it? I think it's a wonderful addition, and having that new infrastructure is a really important part of our city fabric. We've also installed the contraflame lanes downtown on Pacific Avenue, improving bike safety and the city's bike network connections. And I don't know how many of you know this, but the city's bicycle utilization, our ridership downtown, is second in the state only to the city of Davis. We have some of the highest bike ridership rates, and with some of our other projects, we're bound to make further improvements there. And in the coming months, we'll also soon see the construction of Segment 7, the first phase of the rail trail project, which will connect the beach area to the west side, serving local parks and schools all along the way. So the list is not exhaustive. We've been doing a lot of work, and there's other projects too that you'll hear about more from City Manager Bernal and some of the staff and later in the presentation. But I'd also like to call out specifically relates to business. The city has created a business liaison position, as Bonnie mentioned, to assist businesses in connecting with the appropriate city departments. The city's also published a freelance consultant business guide as a companion resource to the business roadmap. Both of those resources are available for free on the city's economic development website. And I encourage you to take advantage of the staff resources by contacting them directly to assist you in your business needs downtown. Last, I'd like to report that during the next month, the city will introduce a new online reporting system to report non-emergency maintenance requests. The goal, like much of the city's efforts, is to develop new systems and new approaches to make sound investments in the safety, the preservation, and the quality of life in our city. And that's not just for today, but that's for future generations. I want to make sure, as a parent myself, that as we start to look at our future, that we're making our investments wisely so that we can create a foundation for our city's future that will be lasting. I hope you enjoy your time today and you feel your time is spent wisely at this presentation. And now I'd like to turn it over to City Manager Martine Bernal to pick up the next phase of the presentation.
Thank you. Welcome. All right, now I have to wear glasses, so I've got to get prepared here for a few minutes. I was going to talk about a couple of topics this morning. As was mentioned, first with respect to homelessness, and then secondly with respect to the city's budget situation and status. These are two major issues that the city's dealing with currently. And have a significant impact on the quality of life in our community, both presently and into the future. So how we deal with those are critical in terms of how the city moves forward with improving the quality of life in our community. With respect to homelessness, I'll start by just sort of giving you a little bit of the big picture, because I think everyone's aware of the impacts. They've definitely been more significant, certainly in recent years. I've been here with the city for 20 years, and I've really never seen the level of impact, the level of homelessness that we've had over the last 5 years in particular. And we're not alone. This is a situation that's facing the state of California and certainly the whole country. But homelessness has clearly increased. California in particular, Just between 2016 and 2017, it's increased by 13.7%. That's a pretty significant increase. The other thing that's critical about the change in homelessness is that the number of unsheltered has also increased, in particular that segment of the population. You have homeless people who are homeless, but they may be living from couch to couch situation. But the number of people that are out there on the streets has definitely increased. And in California, that level is incredibly high, at close to 70%. And in Santa Cruz County and Santa Cruz City, it's closer to 80%. So the majority of individuals who are homeless in our community are out there on the streets, which obviously has impacts on our community on a day-to-day basis. And then when you look at the number of beds that we have, shelter beds available for individuals, it's a relatively small number. So that obviously contributes to the situation. And there are other complexities, obviously, to it with respect to mental health illness, substance abuse issues, and that sort of things that makes it very, very difficult to be able to house individuals and to respond to the situation. So, you know, in light of the large number of individuals that we have unsheltered in our community and in our state, the City Council has really focused on how to address this. In 2017, the City Council established the Homelessness Coordinating Committee, made up of council members, and they came up with a set of recommendations, 20 clear recommendations, some short-term, some longer-term recommendations to try to address the situation immediately and into the future. And those recommendations included a variety of different measures to try to, like I said, address the situation. Some have been implemented already. One of the most significant ones that I think is working out really well, and you probably read about that just in the paper recently, and that's the Downtown Streets team. Again, that was an attempt to try to get the individuals out in the community that are homeless to really try to improve their lives through, you know, work in a dignified way. And that's having an incredible benefit on our community because, you know, homeless individuals, instead of just being out in the community, they are now able to sort of actually contribute back to the community by being out there and cleaning our downtown, cleaning our open spaces, and now they're expanding over to Harvey West and other parts of the community. So that's been really tremendous. We've also attempted to provide linkages for two individuals to be able to go home. We've expanded our Homeward Bound program, for example. So really the best solution for them is to be able to go back to their families, particularly once they're stabilized, and so we do assist individuals doing that. The other piece of the puzzle that has been part of the plan, which we've accelerated, is really the development of and creation of more shelter capacity, because we have a really limited number, as I mentioned to you, and so we've accelerated the establishment of a navigation center, and that really is an attempt to have a shelter that provides services, that provides access, and really works on trying to keep people out of homelessness in a more productive way. So rather than just simply shelter, it also is an attempt to work with individuals on a plan to get out of homelessness or to be able to respond to the situation in a way that's meaningful and also that helps the community overall. So the thing the City Council did in January to address the situation was to declare a shelter crisis, and that was in January. So with respect to our goal to try to increase shelter capacity in the city has embarked on a three-phase plan to do that. One of the things that had been happening for the last few years is as the city was confronted with increasing number of encampments, and again, this is happening throughout the entire state of California, whether it's Fresno, Santa Ana, Orange County, throughout the state of California, there's just an increase in encampments. And so that was a situation certainly in our city. And enforcement really wasn't doing anything other than moving it from place to place. That strategy wasn't necessarily addressing the situation. It might address it temporarily in a particular location, but all it did was then move the problem somewhere else. So we needed to change our approach, like I mentioned earlier, and create that additional capacity for people to at least have a place to be, and also putting the work to try to get them out of homelessness. So the first phase was to create a managed campground. And you all recall that we had the situation here at the Benchlands where we had an encampment that was really unmanaged, unsupervised, and was really problematic. And so we wanted to get away from that. The River Street Camp has been established out on River Street. Obviously called River Street Camp because it's on River Street. But it's been incredibly successful, I have to say. It has provided that opportunity for particularly those individuals that are facing homelessness who really do want to try to get out of homelessness, who really do want to improve their situation, to have the opportunity to do that. Because sometimes some of those basic necessities is all you need to get in a position to try to focus on improving your life. Whether it's just the basic ability to sleep without having to worry about being woken up or harassed or whatever it might be, just being able to shower, just being able to have a bathroom facility. There are also just, quite honestly, there's also just basic, it's sort of a common sense solution too, because from a purely selfish perspective too, because it's much better for us to have individuals that have facilities out in the community rather than being out and essentially creating environmental hazards. So we don't want to do that. So it's been incredibly successful thus far at having individuals have that opportunity to improve themselves. And already we've had some individuals that have been found housing or going into programs to improve themselves. That's pretty tremendous. We've got about 60 or so individuals in the program. We've got a waiting list of close to 50 people. And it has really worked really well within the community in terms of just being able to be compatible within the community to help individuals and also to not impact the community. So that's been, something the city never envisioned a year ago. I wouldn't say that we would necessarily thought we would be doing this, but I think it's been a tremendous success and an addition to the community. But that isn't really a long-term goal. What we want is to have a permanent facility that it's in a building that has appropriate accommodations to deal with the situation. And that's what we want to get to. And again, we felt that we needed to get this going as soon as possible, which is why we came up with a temporary solution. So phase two is to move to another location in a temporary fashion where we can increase the capacity. Because like I said, the need is tremendous. We do want to increase the capacity. We want to be able to have shelter on a year-round basis. We now have only a winter shelter and a very limited number of year-round beds as well. So by increasing year-round capacity and providing services, that would benefit the community tremendously. So we're looking at that, on the April 24th, the City Council will be presented with a variety of options as far as locations to move the facility to another temporary location that would expand capacity and continue to do the good work that they're doing. But ultimately what we want to do is create that permanent navigation center. So we are looking as well as that at acquiring a facility to be able to provide those services on a permanent basis. We're working very closely with our partners at the county. We want to be able to provide navigation centers throughout the county. It's not just an issue in Santa Cruz. Watsonville also has a tremendous need in other parts of the county as well, because this is an issue that's everywhere from Davenport all the way down to, like I said, Watsonville. So ultimately, I think the vision is to have a number of navigation centers spread throughout the community that'll help individuals improve themselves and will also help to address the direct impacts that we have in the community from this issue. If you want to get information about the homelessness and the city's 20 recommendations from our homelessness coordinating committee, we do have a website, and I have the link up here, but all you have to do is go to our website and just on the search type in homelessness and you'll get connected to it. And there's a whole variety of information on all of our plans and what we're doing. So now I'll talk about our budget status. I'll start off by just again talking about the big picture with respect to the status of cities and public agencies really in California and what's happening with respect to their budget situations. We're not alone in that many cities, most cities in California are, and public agencies are facing some significant fiscal challenges. Santa Ana, Santa Barbara, Ventura, comparable cities to us are dealing with very similar budget deficits, if not larger ones. We've chosen to be proactive and to address this as soon as possible and have that conversation with our community. But we are facing a situation of a deficit. And the reasons for it are varied. One of them is that our tax base has been eroding. A number of reasons for that, the rise in online sales, the switch in the way individuals purchase goods now. It's people are moving more to buying services rather than goods, which aren't taxed. And so our overall tax base is just really shrinking as a whole. This is the case for all communities who rely particularly on the sales tax, for example. The other, and it's really a significant one, is the cost of our CalPERS, which is our retirement system. And that really is driven by the state's investment losses. And so our normal costs, our normal pension costs are increasing at a reasonable rate. That's not what's impacting the cost increases. It's not an increase in benefits or just normal costs. It's really the fact that the state system experienced some tremendous, incredible losses in your investment portfolio. In a period of actual economic growth, which is kind of contradictory to what we would expect. And so what's happening is, as a result of those tremendous losses, the way the system works is that they make up the difference by charging member agencies, which are cities, to make up that difference. And so for the city of Santa Cruz and for virtually every city and every county and public agency in California, that means just tremendous increases in our PERS costs. So for the city, it's in the range of $9 to $11 million annually just to cover those investment losses. So that's such a big problem, and again, it's forcing us to have to deal with the situation. We don't have a choice relative to being able to make the payments or not. We're forced to do that. We also have other costs that increases like any other business would encounter, in utilities, health insurance, construction costs, and those sort of things. So we have those same kind of costs. The other that's really critical as we look at our projections and we look at our needs, we also have to look at our facilities and our infrastructure. And we have an older city, we have older facilities, and we need to be able to keep up and maintain those facilities, do the deferred maintenance, and be able to be in a position to replace what we need to replace. And so that is another sort of factor in that contributes to our deficit, because again, we want to be able to project and plan for those needs. Because many times you don't have a choice. I mean, you have to replace the roof at some point. You have to do some of this work in order to keep basic services operating, whether it's public safety or community facilities, that's required. The other sort of significant component of this with respect to infrastructure is the loss of redevelopment. We lost redevelopment, and redevelopment agencies made a huge contribution to economic development, but also to infrastructure. And with that loss, and housing, I mean, it was a critical loss for housing as well. So that has had an impact on cities' ability to be able to invest in infrastructure and some of these other critical needs, and that burden has shifted to the general fund, which again creates that problem. Our deficit is in our general fund. And the city, the way we're structured, is we have a general fund, which is largely funded from taxes and revenues. And we have our enterprise funds, which are funded through fees for service. And you don't find that we have deficits in our enterprise funds. Our enterprise funds include our solid waste fund, our water fund, our sewer fund. And in those funds, we have the ability to manage those revenues and those expenditures much better because we do have the ability, the council has the ability to set the rates and to be able to be proactive in terms of how do you manage those funds. So normally we don't have deficits there. In the general fund, we don't have that ability. The general fund is more like if you're a business and you need to increase the cost of your services or need to for whatever reason, and the way you do that is you have to basically ask your customers if it's okay for you to raise the cost of your services. So it's a challenge to do that. And so we have to rely on the economy and really the support of the public to be able to raise revenues in order to cover those cost increases. But the other thing is that what's funded under the general fund are these really critical services that we rely on a day-to-day basis. You know, it's public safety, which is more than 50% of the fund is police and fire. Parks and recreation is another big component. When you add that, then you're getting close to 70% of the general fund those two areas. And with respect to parks and recreation, in our city, it's a robust set of services because that's why we live here. We love our parks, we love our services. It's recreation, it's our open spaces, it's our community facilities. And we're blessed with a number of them, but they are funded out of the general fund. Public works makes up a component as well, but it's a relatively small, it's mostly facilities maintenance. Most of public works is enterprise funded, but there are some critical pieces with respect to maintaining our facilities, public facilities and public works, and then community programs, which are funding our social service programs, nonprofit. And so when you add all these together, that's over 80% of the general fund is comprised of these areas. So the impact, if we have to, whenever we have to make reductions and address our deficit, really go to these areas. And those are really critical, vital services that our community depends on. I also want to point out that the city has been really a leader in fiscal management for many, many years. We have a tradition of doing that. We have a culture of doing that, and that in large part goes to our leadership that we've had over the years, but also the tremendous and incredible financial staff that we have. They're very proactive at what we do. We're recognized with the awards, national budget and financial awards. Our audits are always clean and well-respected. We are privileged to have earned a AA+ bond rating. Not a lot of cities out in the entire country have this bond rating. There's only one higher bond rating, which is a AAA, which is something that many cities have. So our financial practices have been recognized by our bond rating. With respect to pensions, I mentioned the tremendous costs and burden that we have with those. However, we've done many reforms and have implemented many measures to try to address those costs, to try to reduce those costs, including establishing a pension trust fund. We've paid down our pension unfunded liability. We've established a pension obligation bonds to try to reduce the ongoing debt service and payments for those costs. So we've implemented many of the best practices and measures to really keep those costs down to the extent that we can. And then we have many prudent financial practices, including adequate reserves, and just really looking ahead and planning for these needs. So while you're hearing about the city situation right now, you're gonna hear about virtually every other community having to deal with these same issues. We're one of the first because we're trying to get ahead of it, and we want to be transparent with the community and communicate our situations and the reasons why, and have moved forward with developing really a plan on how to address this. And so that really involves any number of things, including the need to reduce our expenditures and the need to increase our revenue. So we are looking at resetting our general fund by somewhere in the range of $8 to $10 million. The city council in the last fiscal year, in the current fiscal year, reduced the budget by $2.7 million. The current budget that's under development, we're looking at reducing it by $5.5 million. So that's approximately 7 to 8% of our general fund reduction there alone, just to get us through this year and the next. We're also looking at revenue enhancements, both with respect to just improving our economic tax base. And you'll hear about some of the projects that are in play, but the city has been very aggressive about trying to encourage economic development and increasing our tax base. We've got a number of projects that will help in that regard. We've got some mixed-use projects with respect to, for example, the Dreamium project that's moving forward. With respect to the downtown mixed-use projects, we've got a number of hotels that have been constructed or are under development or are currently under construction as well. And all these will help in that regard, and we continue to be proactive about increasing our tax base and revenues. And then, of course, we also have to, the problem is significant enough that we also have to look at raising revenues. And the most significant one that we have in place right now is, as you know, the City Council did place a measure on the ballot to increase the city's sales tax from 9% to 9.25%. That's about a quarter increase in every $100 of spending that people make. And that will generate about $3 million a year to try to address the budget deficit that we have. Looking out at future years, we're looking at about a $20 million deficit, and so that's the problem that we're trying to address, and this will go a long way to addressing that. And so we'll do it with a balanced approach here, with a plan to get ahead of it, in order to, really in the end, our goal is to try to preserve the critical city services that the community expects and that we've been providing and we hope to continue to provide. So again, trying to be proactive at addressing the issue to the extent that we can. So that is the end of my presentation. Next, we've got Lee, who will also talk about